Hello guys, and today I'm going to be teaching you how to make games using the Love2D framework. As you can see, I'm already running my GVim setup. So first of all, I will go into my directory of projects, and then the project name will be Interim. You will know what that means on future videos. I will explain the concept of the game, but for now let's just set our base game engine or something like that. Okay, and we're going to create a main.lua file there, and then okay, so first of all, this is going to be open source. It will be available on GitHub. I will post the description below. And next is, we're not going to use anything or any external modules. We're going to develop, make everything from scratch except for a debugging tool we need, and that is the Love Debug module. I will post that link, the link to that repository. It's also free, be sure to check that out. It's pretty awesome. So in our main.lua, I'm going to use a template, and then press tab. It's a snippet, so love, so there you go, because we need that. And another one for the configuration Lua, and kind of like that. So our name, so the name of the game will be Interim, and then the width of our screen will be 1024, the height will be 720, and that's all that we need. So first of all, if we run this, as you can see, here is our screen. I think that's too small. Okay. 1024 by 720 works. Okay, I'm going to switch this. And then we're going to create in our source directory, we're going to create a game.lua engine. And this is a cool way, this is, I think, the best way to make to load files, is to make first a table local that will contain everything on this file, and then return this. So when we require this, as you can see here, when we say game is equals to require in our source, and then game, we don't need to specify the Lua extension. And we need to require modules, love debug. Okay, there you go. As you can see, this will return a table. Okay, so this will require, this will open this file, this will read the file game in the resource directory, and then that table will be put into this game variable, so we can access that. As you can see, if we print game here, what we will see is a table. There you go. So this is the Love Debug. So it's pretty cool, right? It's like a command line. Just press Shift Control F8, and then we have command here, so we can type like print game. There you go. Okay, and then our game will handle a function called game that initialize. This will take, this will be for setting the screen or the default variables that we need. Turn that game that init, and then need the game width, or let's just say GW for the game width, or W at the height, and then and the function there, and then inside that let's create a global variable. Let's name this global sighting. Do you prefer we name it globals? So anyways, let's just then return that globals also. Oh no, we don't need to return this because it's already on the global variable. So globals, and then globals, I think we should just name this game. And then let's change the name to engine. Yes, this is not an engine, but for now let's just name this engine. We can name this other next time. So game with will take that W parameter, or if the user didn't provide anything, use to use a default or fallback variable value of 1024, and then game that game height that will be height or 720. Then game that screen width, so game width is different from screen width because the screen width will be the window while the game width is the or the canvas or the resolution of the game. So we're going to make this a pixel art game, so we need that. So we will get the value by using love.graphics and then get width that will return the width of the window, and then screen height is equals to love.graphics.getHeights. You should be familiar with the love API, and then we're going to calculate for the ratio because we will need this for scaling things in our draw function. So map that mean, minimum, or mean, or the lowest value, or we will get the lowest value from the variable from the parameters we put. So we will choose between two. So this will be for portrait and for landscape aspect ratio. So game that screen height is higher, so we will get screen height over game that game width. Then I'm just going to fix this. I'm a code OCD sometimes. Game that screen width over game that game width. Oh wait, I messed things up here. This should be game height. Why didn't you tell me? And so let's print the output of that. Okay, so when we use it here, we're going to say game, and then initialize. So if we didn't put anything, oh wait, let me change this into, because we need the self parameter. Okay, so when we run this, screen height any value. Wait a minute. Oh, it's screen, not should be screen, not screen. Silly mistake. Okay, there you go. As you can see, it prints out one. But if we're going to pass a parameter like 320 by 240, we're going to get 3. Okay, so that works. But I will still configure these things because I don't want to call an initial game colon init every time. Or not every time, I mean once, but still, we will make this shorter because the function engine initialize is should always be called. Okay, so for that we're going to use what we call meta tables and meta methods. So what we can do here is put since this will return a table, we can make that table act like a function. And I know that doesn't seem that doesn't look right, but trust me. Okay, so we're going to set meta table. Be sure to spell that out. It's hard. Game. No, it's engine. Engine, comma. And then the second parameter is the table or the meta table we're going to put inside the engine table. Okay, so first we have this index meta table. So refer that. I will explain meta tables and meta methods next videos, but for now just follow this. And our call function, so okay, basically this what the call function does. As you can see here, I have mouse I'm not using. Here When we require this, this will return a table, right? Because return engine and engine is a table. So table is like an array that contains keys and values, but it's not a function. We cannot call that, but we can use meta methods that is the underscore call, so that when a table is a called like a function, the table will look for this call function, and if that exists, this will work. This function call will work because we have this call, like the table. When you call that, and when you call it as a function, that will search its meta tables or meta methods for the call function, and then, as you can see, that refers to a function. So there you go. So we need for the parameter of the call is the t table, which is itself. We'll call itself, and then the I forgot one dot, three dots or ellipses is what you called var arg in Lua, or maybe they change it now, I don't know, but that's called var arguments. Means that's a lot that will be a table that can handle a lot of arguments. Let's say if you have 10 arguments, you can say arg1, arg2, arg3, arg4, and arg2 10. You can just use that. And then we're going to call that the init function. So t is the table, which is actually game. In this case, game, when we call the call function, that the t will be game. So, and then call init, and then this will call this, and then these three dots will handle the parameters for this init. So when we run that, we can see it still prints out one, right? So that works. Let's say we put 320 by 240 again, we should get 3. See, it works. But there's a problem. Let's say we will use another function on the engine class. Let's call this class for now game sample, and then let's create a function called engine sample here, and let's just say print one. Okay, look what will happen. It returns an error because global game is a nil value. How come is that a nil value? We use require and then game here, right? But as you can see, we directly called the initialized or the call meta methods here, which in turn directly called init initialized function here. So this game variable is not purely this table or this file. It's a function call, or it's a function that was called. So when we want to get something from a function, we need to use returns. So return t, this will return engine also. You can substitute t into engine, but let's just use the parameter. Okay, as you can see here, this will work now. See, 3 and then 1 because of our sample function. So let's just delete this because we won't need this anymore. Oh, there you go. So it's pretty cool, right? Okay, so we have our game that ratio, we have that. So let's test if that works. To test if that works, let's how long have I been recording? 14 minutes. Let's make things faster. So let's just print a simple hello world. Love that graphic, set color. Let's make the text white. And then love that graphics that print hello world. And then let's put that in 32 and 32. As you can see, if we run this, we will see that hello world, right? It's there. But since we're going to use a game size that is different on the screen size, we will utilize the use of this game ratio, which we have calculated before. So to make the whole game scale, we will first need to use the push function. I mean, all drawing methods will be pushed and into a buffer, I think. I'm not sure. And then we can use scale. That will scale everything up. And then let's pass in the game ratio. Okay, and then we need to end that. We need to close that with a pop, means return to its normal drawing behavior. If we print out, we can see that hello world got scaled. Oh, world. Sorry, I mistyped that. See, even the 32 and 32 point is scaled. See, so that's what we're going to use for our pixel platformer. Okay, that's the pixel platformer. But as let's run that again. As you can see here, it's kind of blurry, right? Some parts are blurry because it's scaling. The game scales like let's say the game scales it in a way that is not best fit or best suitable for pixel art games, because it's drawing by linear points and not to the nearest neighbor. So if you use graphics editing program, you will notice that when you scale things up. So to fix that, we will use lab.graphics.setDefaultFilter. Yes, the nearest. Then nearest for the maximum scale or filter. Okay, so lab.graphics.setDefaultFilter. Why did we put that in the load and not in the draw function? Because you can put this in the draw function, but let's just put this in the load function so it will only get called once. Because we only need that to get called once. As you can see here, after using that function, we see it's more sharp, it's more detailed, it's more like pixel arty, but still there are some, that's not blurred, okay? That's not blurred, that is just some and the scaling something, because the neighbors or the pixel neighbors act like that. Okay, so we have our base engine, not basically base, but I think this is enough for now. We will add more stuff later. I hope you enjoyed and learned a lot today. Okay, so be sure to subscribe for more videos and have a lovely day. Yes, have a lovely day. Okay, see ya.